Daniel, book of Daniel. Hallelujah. We're going to look at the first chapter. We're going to do extensive reading. So, amen. Amen. This is church. So, reading the Bible shouldn't be a task and a chore. Amen. Glory to his name. All right. Does everybody have it? If you have it, say, I've got it. Amen. Daniel chapter 1, reading starting at verse 1. In the year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and laid siege to it. The Lord, look at this, the Lord, somebody say the Lord, handed Jehoiakim, king of Judah, over to him, along with some of the vessels from the house of God. Excuse me. Nebuchadnezzar carried them to the land of Babylon, to the house of his God, and put the vessels in the treasury of his God. Verse 3. The king ordered Aspenaz, the chief of his court officials, to bring some of the Israelites from the royal family and from nobility, young men without any physical defect, good looking, suitable for instruction in all wisdom, knowledgeable, perceptive, and capable of serving in the king's palace, and to teach them the Chaldean language and literature. Verse 5. The king assigned them daily provisions from the royal food and from the wine that he drank. They were to be trained for 3 years, and at the end of that time, they were to serve in the king's court. Somebody say preparation.
Preparation.
Among them, from the descendants of Judah, were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Verse 7. The chief official gave them over other names. He gave them the name, Belteshazzar to Daniel, Shadrach to Hananiah, Meshach to Mishael, and Abednego to Azariah. Verse 8, Daniel determined that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine he drank. So he asked permission from the chief official not to defile himself. Look at this, verse 9. God had granted Daniel favor and compassion from the chief official. Yet he said to Daniel, "My lord the king assigned your food and drink. I'm afraid of what would happen if he saw your faces looking thinner than those of the other young men your age. You would endanger my life with the king." Verse 11. So Daniel said to the guard whom the chief official had assigned to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then examine our appearance and the appearance of the young men who are eating the king's food, and deal with your servants based on what you see." Verse 14. He agreed with them and about this, and he tested them for 10 days. Verse 15, at the end of 10 days, they looked better and healthier than all the young men who were eating the king's food. So the guard continued to remove their food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. Verse 17. God gave these four young men knowledge and understanding in every kind of literature and wisdom. Daniel also understood visions and dreams of every kind. At the end of the time that the king had said to present them, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. Verse 19. The king interviewed them, and among all of them, no one was found equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they began to serve in the king's court. Verse 20. In every matter of wisdom and understanding that the king consulted them about, he found them, say this, 10 times better than all the diviner priests and mediums in his entire kingdom. Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus. So far, the reading of God's holy word. Amen. Now, if the topic I'm going to be speaking from today is in the series that Prophet Kendall began on the ministry of preparation, it is called Developing a Spirit of Excellence. Say that with me. Developing a spirit of excellence. Developing a spirit of excellence. Father, we ask you that you would help us, that you would bless us, that you would speak to us, that you would instruct us as only you can. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, having read all of that and having given you my title, I am going to tell you that this message is a little rough. It's a little rough. Now, listen, it's not rough because of just the fact that, you know, it's a beat you up, beat you down type message. It's rough because this is a mental adjustment for everybody, all of us. This message, I don't care who you are or how long you've been saved, you can't escape this from applying somewhere in your life. Somewhere in your life, you could be more excellent than you are. Hello. Somewhere in your life. So that means I don't escape it. You don't escape it. You know, Prophet Kendall doesn't escape it. The kids don't escape it. Nobody escapes this word. Now, let me give you a disclaimer. All right, y'all ready? You know, it's important that when you're about to partake of something, you know, if you're about to sign a document or what, read the disclaimer. Look at somebody and tell them, read the disclaimer. Here's the disclaimer. Understand that the content of this message has nothing to do with whether you are saved or not. Hallelujah. What am I saying? I'm saying if you sloppy and raggedy, you can still go to heaven. This message is not a message of saying, it's not a message of saying that you are being excellent to be saved. Okay? So I got to take that bullet out of guns that have fallen into this trap of now what you do doesn't matter because of grace. Oh, you know, you're preaching works. No, I'm not preaching works. Works to get saved is the issue. But the Bible says we are saved unto good works. What does that mean? That means that though works are not a requirement for your salvation, faith is a requirement for your salvation, works should be a result of. Good works should be a result of what you have received. Hallelujah. So this is not teaching you that you need to do this to obtain salvation. This is teaching us how do we posture ourselves as kingdom citizens. I'm already in the kingdom, right? So how do I posture myself? How should I conduct my life as a child of God? Are you with me? All right. So let's get into it. So I don't expect too many amens. And if you sit there and look at me, that's entirely on you. But I'm going to give you what the Lord has given me because I believe the Lord has given me this. Amen. Why? He's preparing us. He's not just preparing us corporately, but he's preparing us individually. Look at somebody and say, you have an individual destiny. You have something that only you can do. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I said there is something that God has assigned to your life that only you can do. I can't fulfill your purpose, and you can't fulfill mine. Amen. So this is something that you need to apply to your life, and by extension, it will enhance what God has given us as a vision for the ministry corporately. Bishop Tudor Bismarck says something very powerful. He said, it is very difficult to teach church people vision, corporate vision, when many of them don't have a personal vision. They don't have any idea how to have goals, how to set plans in place, and how to reach those goals. Then we come to church, and then the preacher starts talking about vision and supporting and getting behind the vision, but you don't know how to do that for your own life. How many of you know that God is not just concerned about what we do together? God is concerned about what do you do when you leave here? Who are you when you're by yourself? When there's no accountability partner and there's no prayer line and there's nobody preaching to you. Who are you then? How do you live then? How do you think then? How do you conduct yourself then? Are you with me? So this is a difficult issue. This is a difficult subject because it's a problem in the body of Christ. Talk to Carissa all the time about the ministry that God has given her about entertainment. Here's the problem with Christian entertainment. It sucks. Stop me if I'm wrong, sis. Christian entertainment is shoddy. The quality is right. It's getting better, but overall, it could be better. We're not known for excellence. Christian movies, you got a special effect, you know, and it's a dinosaur on a stick or a bird on a stick. Like, that's the special effect in the Christian movie. Like, my God, what is this? What is this? And somewhere we're missing something. So this is a problem in the body of Christ. We love to throw stuff together for the Lord. But you don't throw it together at work. You don't throw it together in corporate America. But when it comes to the things of the Lord, we throw things together. We start businesses and it's shoddily done. Like, the Christian businesses should be the best businesses. Why? Because they have integrity. They get it done right. They don't cut corners. All right. I don't want to get ahead of myself. This is also an issue in our culture because, believe it or not, this culture breeds mediocrity. Why does it breed mediocrity? Let me tell you one of the ways. Just give you a practical way that the culture breeds mediocrity. Fast food, microwave food. So what do we have? A whole generation of people who don't know how to cook nothing. You drop them off in the desert with a pot and a pan and some fire and some grease and some raw potatoes and egg, and they would die of starvation. Don't know what to do. This ain't Hungry Man. Where's the microwave? Hello? That's the culture. The culture makes everything easily accessible. Everything quick. Everything now. And it breeds mediocrity. It breeds laziness. The culture, what we call technology, really has made people lazy. So we don't really read books. We can just read a synopsis. Just Google it. Oh, I get it. I got the gist. Hallelujah. It's also an issue in some ethnicities. Just look straight ahead. I'm not talking to you. Look straight ahead. I'm just look straight ahead. It's also an issue in some ethnicities where there's even a heightened and more of a aggressive attempt to breed mediocrity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we fall prey. We fall in prey. We fall in prey to a system that has been designed to make it easy to be average. Oh, God. Y'all stay with me. I'm going somewhere. So this topic is challenging because many of us have been nursed on the milk of mediocrity. We have sucked from the breast of mediocrity, and we become lazy. Many of us have grown up being allowed to think that just enough should be celebrated just as much as those that go above and beyond. Well, I came to work. I showed up. We want a cookie just because we showed up. We won an award just because we came. I deal with this every day as a manager. People who are just doing the bare minimum. I should be an exceeds. Why should I give you an exceeds rating when you're just meeting the bare requirements? So we have a generation of people who feel like they should be rewarded for barely doing. Hallelujah. Many of us have grown to become satisfied with at least I did something, even if it's shoddy or thrown together. Even if it's shoddy or thrown together. You know, like how we have cleaned our homes? How we just tidy up? How we just kick the stuff that we don't want to handle under the couch, under the bed, in the closet, and say we cleaned. That's what we do. That's what we do. And we're satisfied. We have called, we've lowered the definition of clean to fit what we are willing to do. Oh God. Standards are here. Do you know that as a child of God, our standards should actually be higher? Higher than those who are children of darkness? But again, like we talked about a few weeks ago, the children of darkness are wiser than the children of light. This should not be so. Hello. This should not be so. Developing a spirit of excellence is critical to the ministry of preparation. So what does this mean? This means you may not have an excellent spirit right now. And when I use the term spirit, I'm meaning it in the sense of your mind, your mindset. When you look at the term spirit in scripture, it's not always talking about that aspect of us that is that inner aspect of us, the spirit of a man. I'm talking about your mind. When I say the spirit of excellence, it's a mind, it's a mindset. You with me? Developing a spirit of excellence is critical to the ministry of preparation. Why? Why is it critical? Let's look at Proverbs 22 and 29 real quick. Proverbs 22, 29. I don't expect you to shout. I expect you to listen, though. Proverbs 22 and 29 says this. Do you see a man skilled in his work? It's a question. It says, he will stand in the presence of kings. He will not stand in the presence of unknown men. What am I saying? what is the scripture saying here? The scripture is saying that a person who is skilled at what they do will stand before people of affluence, affluent people, people of influence. Here's another scripture that will make that connect just a little more for you. Your gift will make room for you and bring you before great men. Here's the problem. We have gifts that we don't develop. We have gifts we don't develop. We have ideas that we don't develop. We have concepts that we don't develop. Are you with me? So you can't expect something that you may have, but that you've not put anything into, to produce what it will produce for people that have put the work in. This person is skilled, and because of their skill, it has opened up doors of opportunity. We have to get out of the mindset, children of God, that things will be handed to us just because we are saved. So we pray, but we don't read. And I'm not talking about the Bible, per se. We pray, but we don't read. We worship, but we don't research. We don't make ourselves more knowledgeable, more marketable. We don't make ourselves an asset. Everybody want to get married, but you're not an asset yet. I'm not just talking about women. I'm talking about men too. Everybody wants a boo, but you're a liability. Why am I a liability? Because you got more bills than the Federal Reserve. Can I get some help? I need some help. They looking at me. Carissa going to defend me today. I need security. Where's security? you see what I'm saying? We're not an asset. We're a liability. You got more emotional issues and more baggage. You got freight. You got freight. Which makes you a liability, not an asset to somebody's life. You will take more than you can give. Hello. So we gotta change the thinking and change the mindset and do the work. Do the work that it takes to be excellent in every area of your life. Okay, let's look at what excellence is, just so I can level set so you understand what I'm saying, so we all on the same page. Excellence means the quality of being outstanding. Oh. See, listen, the Bible says not to think more highly of yourself than you ought. It doesn't say be mediocre. See, it's saying be excellent, but be humble. It means have your stuff together, but carry yourself like you're just like everybody else. Come on, we've twisted and we've contorted scripture and we've used it as an opportunity to be less than, to do less than. All right, here's the thing. It's not simply that you will act on the next level of your life or ministry just like you did on the last. See, that's what we talked about. We talk about, you know, you got to live on this level like you are on the next. So it's not simply like you'll just, you know, the fear or the danger in being mediocre or being average is that you'll be average on the next level. The danger is you won't get to the next level. Average, being mediocre, being lazy, not having that quality, not striving to be excellent, outstanding, or here's another one, extremely good at what God has given you? Natural, spiritual, personality, all of that. We should strive as believers to be outstanding or extremely good. Here's a better word that might encapsulate it. Exceptional. Do you know that you have the exceptional one in you? And that he's given you the power to be exceptional? What do you think the Holy Ghost is for? The Holy Ghost, he didn't give you the Holy Ghost to be average. He didn't give you his spirit to be natural. He gave you his spirit to be supernatural. Supernatural is above average. My God. That's what the Holy Ghost is for. He's not just so that you can speak in tongues and roll in the floor and head roll back in your eyes and run around the church. He gave you the power and ability to be above average. To be excellent. Because he knows that sin inhibited your ability to be excellent. Adam, when he was made, Adam was excellent. He was exceptional. God looked at him and said, it's good. And God saying something is good is not the same thing as you saying something is good. When God says something is good, it's daggone spectacular. And he gave Adam everything Adam needed to be above average. He didn't make Adam in the vein of the other animals. He made Adam better than the animals. He made Adam more excellent than the animals. He gave him a higher mental capacity. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. He says, I'm going to make you so excellent, you're going to rule in the situation that I put you in. My God. I got to walk this slow. That's why I wanted to get started early. Because you got to get this word. And if you start worrying about chicken, you're not going to hear what God is saying. If we don't make this adjustment, this mental shift, then we will never see the next level we keep preaching and prophesying about. God cannot give you more if you can't handle where you are now. If you can't take the little bit that he's given you and rule it well and handle the one like it's 500 and plan and strategize and think about it and think about ways of improving. Some of you never think about ways of improving your life. You never think about ways of improving your financial situation. You never think about ways. You are satisfied with mediocrity. You are satisfied with being average. When God has given us a spirit of excellence, he's given us the ability, should we take up the challenge, to be outstanding. We can be outstanding fathers. We can be outstanding mothers. We can be outstanding husbands. We can be outstanding wives. We can be outstanding employees. So it ain't the job you want. Excel in it and make them create another position. God. Be the best fry cook they got till they have to move you to the register. Then rule the register till they gotta give you the store. Innovate register. Innovate how to count and how to keep track of the money. Innovate. Stop thinking because you got the Holy Ghost, he's just going to open up doors for you that you're not ready to handle. Put you in situations that you haven't caused excellence to be birthed in your integrity yet. You haven't caused excellence to be birthed in your timeliness yet. You haven't caused excellence to be birthed in your commitment and faithfulness yet. My God. We'll never get to the next level without excellence. Look at somebody and say, it's time to get excellent. It's time to be excellent. It's time. It's time to be excellent. It's time not to just be mediocre. It's time to stop just doing the bare minimum. It's time to stop living a life where we just simply get by. See, that's what's wrong with many people in this country. They're satisfied with the support that the government gives. They're satisfied with that. They're satisfied with that. See, but a spirit of excellence will cause you never to be satisfied with mediocrity. Never to be satisfied with someone else doing for you what God has given you the power to do for yourself. That's why some of us stay in bad relationships, because we don't have excellence. The little bit he does do. I need help with the kids. Then do something about it. Hello? Do something about it. I can't take care of my kids. Then start taking a class in the time where you're surfing on Facebook, when you're on Instagram, when you're on Tumblr. You could be taking an online class. You could be getting a certification, but we're not excellent. So we would rather take the shortcut of shacking. We would rather take the shortcut of compromise. See, I threw out shacking. Some of y'all, that don't apply to me. Compromise applies to all of us, because we all compromise in different ways. But compromise is a shortcut. It's a shortcut. It is not the excellent way. My God. Are you with me? Hallelujah. Here's what nobody has really told us. The God we serve is an excellent God. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all of the earth. Why is God's name excellent? Why is his name big stuff? Look around. Look at creation. Look at the handiwork of God. Look up in the sky at night. My God. He's an excellent God. He didn't just fling them out there, but everything in space is in systems. Everything in space has its orbit and its place. He's not haphazard. He's an excellent God. He thought it out so that the earth wouldn't crash into the moon. He thought it out so that the other planets would not crash into the earth, so that the earth wouldn't fall into the sun and burn up. He said, oh Lord, how excellent. How excellent is your name. My God, we serve an excellent God, and everything he does is excellent. Everything he does is excellent. Everything he thinks is excellence. My God. Everything that excellence is running through his mind. My God. Exceptional is running through his mind. Outstanding thoughts are running through his mind. He's an excellent God. He's an excellent God, and he made us in his image and in his likeness, which means that he's given us the capacity to be excellent like he's excellent. See, sin might have messed it up, but see, he sent Jesus for that, because he's an excellent God. He's an excellent God. He was the lamb slain before the foundation of the earth, because God is so excellent. He was prepared. He was prepared. He had the answer to the problem before the problem ever came into being. He's excellent. He's excellent. He's excellent. He never half does anything. He never half does anything. He didn't half do creation. He doesn't half do salvation. He doesn't half do sanctification. He doesn't half heal you. He doesn't half deliver you. He doesn't half call you. He's excellent. He's exceptional. He does what he does, and he does it well. That same capacity is in you. I want you to help me, because some of y'all, the enemy is stopping you from receiving this word. I want you to touch somebody and tell them that same capacity is in you. It's in you. You can be excellent. It's a lie from the enemy that tells you that you can't. You can be outstanding. You can be a cut above the rest. Bible teaches us that when we perform in our optimum capacity, when we perform at the level that we were created to perform in, then we show forth the praises of him. This is not showing forth the praises of him. This is not showing forth the praises of him. When I do what I was created to do better than anybody else does it, I'm showing forth the excellency of my God. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency may be of God and not of us. Come on, he's excellent. Come on, he's excellent. And there's excellent. The embryo of excellence is in you. The seed of excellence is in you. The seed of creativity and greatness is in you. Didn't come. God didn't call us to pastor a church of normal people. God didn't call us to raise up a bunch of mediocre people, but God called us to raise up excellent people. People who know who they are. People who know who they are. People who do what they do better. So I won't preach down. I can't do nothing but preach you up. I won't get down and wallow in your mess with you. You want me to preach about the fact that you're lonely. You want me to preach about the fact that you're broke. But no, I gotta call you out of that into your purpose. We got enough preachers out here that are sympathizers. You got enough preachers out here that won't tell you who you are, because they want to control you, because they want to keep you contained. But God doesn't want you controlled. He wants you set free. My God. See, the crown, the jewel in my crown won't be they came and they stayed. The jewel in my crown will be they came and they grew and they became greater and they excelled and they knew their God and they began to do exploits. That's the jewel. My God. Whoo, Holy Ghost. Oh, I come against that spirit of mediocrity. I come against that spirit of just wanting to fit in. I come against that spirit of wanting to stay in the back of the line and sit in the back of the room. I come against that spirit of anonymity. I come against that spirit that's afraid to be great, that's afraid to get out front, that's afraid to lead the charge, that's afraid to be the first. I'll break that spirit in Jesus' name. My God, my God, he said, do business. He said, occupy. He said, occupy. That word occupy means to do business until I come. Thank you. He said, do business until I come. That means we should be at the forefront. That means we should be shaking and moving and making things happen. You can't advance the kingdom if you won't advance. can't advance the kingdom if you won't advance. Hallelujah. You got to understand, it's not that God can't use you if you aren't excellent. That's not what I'm saying. See, I got to be very clear in this word, because people like to cherry pick and take and choose what they think you're saying. But let me be very clear. I'm not saying God can't use you if you're not excellent. What I am saying, it just means that there are certain assignments he can't give you. There are certain situations he can't put you in. Oh, God. Oh, God. See, you just limit your growth potential in the kingdom. That's what you do. You limit your own. You put a cap and a ceiling on your own potential when you refuse to be excellent. When you refuse to allow God to make you exceptional wherever he has put you. All right. Let's look at Daniel. In our text, we find the fulfillment of prophecy given by Jeremiah that Israel would once again go into captivity for about 70 years. 70 years. Nebuchadnezzar, the evil ruler of Babylon, has laid siege to Jerusalem. He's taken the king of Judah, items from the temple, and many of the best of the royal family and the nobility. Nobility is simply the folks with means, folks with money. Those are your noble people. He's taken them. He's taken them. He's laid waste to Jerusalem, and he's pillaged it. See, this is what the enemy's been doing since creation. He's laid siege to the city of God, to God's creation, to God's people. Do you hear what I'm saying? He's laid siege. He's laid siege. Y'all don't hear me. He's laid siege. And the enemy, he doesn't just simply come and destroy everything, but he takes the best. He takes the best. He takes the best of what God has created. Look at the world around you. Why is it that the world has all the best, or that people feel like they have to go to the world? Because that's where the best are. It's not so. It shouldn't be so. It shouldn't be named among us that the best of the world is outside of the house of God. Shouldn't be named among us. The Bible says that the men that he took had no defects, no disabilities, and they were bright and they were teachable. My God. Understand that everyone has a dimension of teachability. Everyone. The question is, who's teaching? See, you don't have to teach your kids the word. Don't worry, because they will be taught, because they are teachable. You can think your kids cannot be taught, but the world will teach your kids. Television will teach your kids. Your kids' friends will teach your kids. They're teachable. These men were, they were bright and they were teachable. It is sad that the world is better at seeing the potential in people than the church. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's sad that the world is more perceptive about the gifts and talents, that we have limited God to preaching and singing. And teaching and ushering.
Right.
And that's all we focus on. Not here. The devil is a lie. Why? Because God is bigger than just those elements. God is giving you ideas God is giving you inventions. God is giving you businesses. God is giving you passions. But he's given them to you to use for the advancement of his kingdom. When you take your gifts and you have to just use them in the world, and the world directs how you use them, you can't advance God's kingdom. See, God is trying to raise up people within the body of Christ to create new platforms and new opportunities and new paradigms for gifted Christian people to be able to be gifted as the world but still be saved. But we don't want to start a company. We don't want to start our own production company. We don't want to start. So we have to go to them. Enemy just cherry picks. Cherry picks. Daniel and his contemporaries give us the Old Testament witness of what it means, however, because they were in a situation that they couldn't control. They were taken into captivity. They were prisoners of Nebuchadnezzar. They had no choice but to go. But they show us the power of what it means to be in the world, but not of the world. Do you know you can be in the world until the paradigm is created, until the platforms are created for believers to support one another and work together, which that's a whole nother. Because who gonna get credit? That's how the church moves. Who gonna get credit? We can't come together because everybody wants the credit. Everybody wants to say it was their idea. Everybody wants to be at the helm. Nobody wants to support something somebody else is doing. To realize that we all win when one of us wins. If you succeed and I help you succeed, I've succeeded too. Come on. I'm talking about an excellent mindset. That's an excellent mindset. That's an exceptional. My God. That's an exceptional mindset. Stay with me. Let's look at verse 8. Hallelujah. Verse 8 says, Daniel determined that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine he drank. My God. Daniel determined that he would not be defiled. Daniel determined that he would not be contaminated by his surroundings. See, we've got to understand that when we begin to move in the excellency of God, It cocoons us. It secures us. It inoculates us in a world that is designed to contaminate you. The world is trying to contaminate the church. The world is trying to contaminate Christianity. The world is trying to infect us. The world is trying to put leaven in the loaf. A little leaven, leaveneth the whole loaf. You can't mix a little of the world's philosophy with a little of God's philosophy and think that God's philosophy cleans it up. See, that's what the devil did. He took a little bit of the truth and mixed it with a little bit of the lie. Making the whole thing a lie. My God. And Daniel said, I refuse to be contaminated. I refuse to be infected. I refuse. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I'm in this situation, but I don't have to let it get in me. Oh, I came to talk to somebody today that you've let situations get in you. You've let circumstances get in you. You've let past experiences get in you. But God put you in and allowed you to go into the situation so that you could affect the situation, not so that it would affect you. Some of us need a detox. Look at somebody and say, you need a spiritual detox. You've taken on some things. You need a mental detox. You've taken on some ideas, some concepts, some philosophies that are not in alignment with the word of God, that are not in alignment with kingdom values. You need a detox. So he asked for permission, and he got that permission contingent upon the fact that they would not look more sickly and more weak than those whom were their contemporaries in slavery. Oh, God. See, the problem is we have compromised and we have taken in the king's meat and drink. But instead of even being at the level of those who are our contemporaries, we are weaker than them. We are weaker than them. We are sickly and we're deficient with the name of Jesus, with the Holy Ghost, with speaking in tongues, but we're more miserable. We're more impotent. My God. But it's time to detox. See, this is what the word helps you do. The word helps you detox. The word helps you recalibrate. The word helps you to say, okay, I need to pluck that weed up. I need to tear down that imagination. I need to bring that thought into captivity. I thought that was God. I thought that was okay, but no, that's not okay. That has caused me to be weakened and not strengthened. They said, if you let us eat what we eat, we'll be better than those that eat from the king's table. See, you got to know what works for you. You got to know. You got to know. Some of you haven't realized that there's some things you can't do. Other people do it. You can't do it. Hello? Other people seem okay after they do it, but when you do it, your spirit is messed up. When you do it, you can't pray right for a week. When you do it, you can't hear from God. See, I'm talking about an excellent spirit. An excellent spirit is a disciplined spirit. Come on, an excellent mind is a disciplined mind. An excellent person lives a disciplined lifestyle. They're not led by what other people are doing. They're led by what God has commanded of them. My God. Bible says that they were examined for 10 days and their appearance was better after they were tested. They were healthier. They looked better than the young men who were eating the king's food. So their attendant had to determine that what they're doing is better. It's better. See, people will get off your back when they start seeing you prosper from doing right. I know they don't understand. I know they think you crazy. I know they think, girl, you better go get you some. You know, you better drive the car before you buy it. I know that that's what the world's theology and philosophy is, but do you understand that when you have an excellent spirit and you decide to do things God's way, that God will bless you so that it will show to those who are waiting on you to look miserable and sad and lonely and upset? that when you walk according to God's standard and God's way, that God will bless you without their rules? My God. My God. Let's pick up at verse 17. God gave these four young men knowledge and understanding and every kind of literature and wisdom. Daniel also understood visions and dreams. These men were gifted. That's just the long and short of what verse 17 says. These men were gifted. I want you to look at your neighbor. I want you to encourage them. I want you to prophesy them. I want you to declare in their life. Look at them and say, you're gifted. You're gifted. You are gifted. You are gifted. God doesn't send anyone into this world empty. Hello. God doesn't send anyone. It's a lie. I don't care who told you. I don't care if your gift is weird, quirky. It's not normal. It's not average. You are gifted. And some of you have allowed people to talk you out of what God has put in you. These boys were gifted. Why? God does not produce empty containers. Oh, you don't believe it. He reached down in the dust of the earth and he formed the man, but it wasn't good enough. God doesn't create empty stuff. He breathed. He breathed. Because God doesn't, he doesn't produce empty stuff. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. He created vegetation, but that wasn't good enough. He had to put something in it. He said, I gave it seed. So that it could continue to reproduce. God doesn't, he doesn't produce anything empty. He said, what's wrong with this situation? There's water, but there's nothing in it. So he put fish in it. See, here's what God is showing us. God is showing you, he's showing you an aspect of his character. Here it is. He says, I'm the filler of all things. He says, I fill all space. See, that's why what the Bible means when it says that by him all things consist. In him we live, in him we move, in him we have our being. He's the filler of all things. My God. See, this is why God can't move. See, God can't move because if God moves, then material things begin to disappear because he's the reason that it's held together. He fills that space between the molecules and the atoms that they've not been able to identify how it's held together. God says, I'm the filler of empty things. I'm the filler of all space. He says, even if you can't see it, when you can't see it, you know I'm there. When you can't put it under a microscope, he says, because you can't see me with a microscope. No man has seen God at any time. My God. These men were gifted. Come on, somebody say, I'm gifted. Somebody say, I got a calling. Somebody say, I got a purpose. Somebody say, he sent me here full. Shouted, he sent me here full.
He sent me here full.
Ooh. Ooh. See, that's what the fight has been about. That's what the war has been over. The enemy has been trying to rob you and sap you of what you were sent here full of. You were sent here full of hope. You were sent here full of life. You were sent here full of ideas. You were sent here full of gifts. I'm gifted. Come on, somebody shout it again. I'm gifted.
I'm gifted.
Y'all didn't shout it. Shout, I'm gifted.
I'm gifted.
Gifted. At the end of the time that the king had said to them, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. Verse 19. Here it is. The king interviewed them, and among all of them, no one was found equal to. Somebody say excellence.
Excellence.
excellence. They were outstanding. They were outstanding. They were exceptional. They were extremely good. There was no one that was found equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they began to serve in the king's court. In every matter of wisdom and understanding that the king consulted them about, he found them 10 times better. 10 times better. Nowhere do you see that they said they were 10 times better. See, you don't have to give your own press release. You don't have to blow your own horn. You don't have to speak highly of yourself. That when you move in excellence, others will look at you and say, they're good. Others will look at you and say, they're better. You don't got to speak of yourself. God will make your enemies praise you. He'll make your enemies your footstool. That's how your enemies become your footstool. Because they create a platform for you to be elevated. That the words that they say, that praise you, they recommend you when they don't want to recommend you. They give you opportunities.
My God.
But if you won't be excellent in all things, if you won't allow this spirit of excellence to be developed in you, if you won't change how you think to be like the God that you serve, those doors and opportunities can't be open to you. They can't be open to you. See, how else can we be the city sat upon a hill? How else can we be the light of the world unless we shine in every way? Let me give you another scripture. Look at this. 2 Corinthians 8 and 7 says, now as you excel in everything, there it is again. This is Paul. He's saying, now as you excel in everything, faith. Look at this, speech. Look at this, knowledge. And in all diligence. There's that word again. Then we just talk about diligence, didn't we? Diligence. Meaning I'm consistent and I'm a hard worker. I excel. I outwork others. It says, and in your love for us, it says this, also excel in grace. My God. What is this saying? God wants you to excel in every aspect of your life, spiritually, naturally, relationally, financially. Look at somebody and say, it's time to excel. It's time to excel. It's time to excel. It's time to tap into the fullness of the potential that's down on the inside of you. See, we got to stop shouting about potential and we got to start mining it. You know, if I buy a piece of land and they tell me that it's a oil well under it, and I get on the land and I'm like, woohoo! I got oil in this land. Woo! My goodness! Oil is in here! Oil! I got it! I own the land! That's what we do in church. Oil! Woo! I go Texas tea. Oil. Where the clamp is at? Oil! If you don't mine it, you'll never live from it. And that's what many of you are stuck in the potential zone. Your ideas are just potential with no legs, no plan. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Just potential. Whew. My God. God is saying, dig it up. Mine that potential. Pursue that dream. Pursue that idea. Pursue that calling. Pursue that ministry. And you can. Look at this. My God. Colossians 3 and 23 says this. Work willingly at whatever you do. I like that. Because what that means is I don't wait to be excellent when I have the thing that I want to do. How many of us have jobs that we don't want to do right now? We wish we were doing something else. Let me see your hand. Wish I was doing something else. Do you even know what it is you want to do? Do you know the first step to take to getting in the direction of doing it? Are you blowing them away where you are? So that if you ever needed a reference, listen. Some stuff shouldn't be a shock. What do I mean? I mean, when people hear certain things you want to do because your life is so excellent, it shouldn't shock them. What? You? You never get here on time. You? You're in a bad mood every day. You? My God. God is calling us into excellence in every area of our lives. God challenged me with this as I was preparing for this message, even with cleaning the house. You know, the old saying says that cleanliness is next to godliness. Now, that may not have scriptural context, but it does have a context. And here's the context. What your life looks like reflects your relationship with the Lord. Some of our houses are messes because we're a mess on the inside. Hello? That's why some of us are accustomed to living in filth. It's filth. I don't care what you say. It's filth. And it's not excellent. And it does not typify God, how he moves and how he thinks. We have to become excellent in every area of our life. Excellent in how we handle our finances. Excellent in how we raise our children. Excellent in how we do our jobs. Excellent in love. Hello. We should excel. But there are people in the world who love better than you, and you say you got the love. Love, the one who is love, living on the inside of you, but you don't do people. I didn't say you wasn't going to heaven. Now, with that one, maybe. Maybe. Maybe that one will keep you out. But. No, I'm serious. We should excel in love. We should excel in joy and peace. Every area. Touch somebody and tell them, quit compartmentalizing God. Stop. Tell them, stop compartmentalizing God. He wants to make you excellent in every way. Not highly gifted and anointed and mean as hell. Huh? Not can cast out a devil, but can't speak to your neighbor. Intercede, tear the house down in prayer, but can talk about everybody without blinking. See, God is calling us to excel in all things. He's calling us to be excellent. We must develop it. We must develop it. This must be developed. This is not optional for those that are believers. If you're not saved, I ain't talking to you. They got systems and programs and things out there for you. But if you are a believer, this is a kingdom principle.